So thank you very much. Let me start by establishing my credentials, because many of you will wonder why a lawyer is attending a conference such as this. Indeed, quite a number of my friends posed the question, why are you attending a scientific conference in agriculture? I think I'm in the right place for a number of reasons. And Mr. Chairman, you'll give me a little more time because I'm going to pace myself to allow the simultaneous interpreters to interpret. So I'm given 10 minutes, but I ask that you give me 5 more because I'm not speaking normal speed. I have had the advantage of listening and walking around, and I'll be faithful to my subject. Number one, I've written a paper which is something between a speech and an academic paper. It will be circulated to you. Number two, I want to just mention a few things why I think that African agriculture will never be transformed unless we change. Number one, when the vice president of Burundi was here, the entire press corps was around. They have now gone. And what is going to be reported in the newspaper tomorrow is that he opened the conference, and after that, what you are doing for the next 1 week will never be mentioned, except on 13th, when the Minister for Agriculture will be closing. That is Africa's tragedy, number one. Number two, the other reason why I don't think we'll go very far, and with due respect to all those who are funding this organization, it is DFID, it is USID, all non-African institutions. I invite you to read Dambisa Moyo's Dead Aid. Africa will go nowhere as long as Africa depends on friends of goodwill, whose names we keep on changing from time to time. Donors, development partners, will never go anywhere. Number three, I've gone around here and collected a lot of literature. I can assure you that very few Africans know about that literature. In my village, I'm considered a very serious farmer, which is a tragedy because I'm not. I'm a lawyer. And as long as that continues to happen, and you have these conferences where you sit and write good papers, but there is no umbilical cord with the African farmer, Africa is going nowhere. So I'm here for two reasons. As a farmer, pretending farmer, to identify the key issues that I think are relevant going forward, and number two, to annoy and to irritate you. Because it is only when you are annoyed and irritated that you will descend from your high academic and intellectual pedestals to connect with the African farmer. So, it is not lost on me that you are experts in your own field. And in my paper, I've said that perhaps I'm like a young maiden trying to teach grandmothers the finer points of suckling, which I'm not. So what is agriculture? 50 years ago, many African countries attained independence on the promise that they would feed their people. 50 years later, Africa is still complaining. 50 years later, there are no shortage of universities that describe themselves as universities of agriculture and technology. 50 years later, there is no shortage of research institutions which are donor-funded. 50 years later, many Africans are dying younger than they were dying in 1963. 50 years later, the nutrition levels have gone down. 50 years later, my rural village is worse off than it was when I was a young boy. 50 years later, we have generated numerous refereed papers. 50 years later, we have acquired PhDs and professors in different areas in agriculture, but 50 years later, a basket case. The question is, what is the problem? When you take time, as I've taken during the tea break, to go out there, to look at what has been written by CARI, what has been written by the various organizations across the 11 countries, the food that is produced, whether it's coffee in Ethiopia, vanilla in Madagascar, coffee and livestock in Eritrea and different countries, let me tell you that you are very far from Africa. You do not have the pulse of Africa. Africa does not understand you. Africa does not even appreciate you, because Africa does not know the good things you are doing, which are very good. So how are we going to change Africa? Is it by having annual jamborees? Is it by having high-level conferences of the scientific kind? Is it by writing numerous papers which are refereed, which are read amongst yourselves, preaching to the converted? Is it by relying on donors and donor funding from DFID, and I thank them, from USAID, and I thank them, from the World Bank, and I thank them, from all the organizations, and I thank them? No. Africa must go down to the basics. It is only when Africa goes down to the basics and begins to talk to herself honestly and sincerely that Africa will begin to realize our potential. Today, let us look at livestock. Our own institutions in Kenya import beef from Brazil. And yet our Kenya Meat Commission is collapsing. And yet Kenya is the home of ILRI, which is an international organization that has beautiful literature on milk and milk processing. I can confirm to you, in our supermarkets in Nairobi, we still have eggs from Romania and butter from Denmark. What are we doing in livestock when we still have individuals engaging in poaching as an ethnic sport in the 21st century? And even if we moved into aquaculture, in my own rural village, they still fish like Adam and Eve did, while China is producing fish from fish farms, and there are no shortage of professors in aquaculture. If you go into the area of maize production, right now it is forecast that in my own country, Kenya, we'll have food shortages. Yet the whole idea of food security is older than Jesus Christ. Go and read the book of Genesis and how Joseph dealt with it. And one can go on and on. I've already been warned that I only ought to speak for 5 minutes. Do not know why I was brought here to speak for only 5 minutes. You will have the occasion to read my paper and understand and appreciate its full flavor. In many areas in Africa, including my village and in your village, you still have farmers going out with seed and throwing it about in the hope that by divine intervention they'll grow. While in Israel, they are using drip technology. These are the questions that you must ask yourselves. You must ask yourself, how many people have you touched? Not just writing a refereed paper in a journal. How many people do you employ? What are you doing on the ground? So going forward, as I conclude, what must we do? Number one, we must liberate ourselves from the chains of donor dependency. Dambisa Moyo is so right, as long as Africa is fed by donors. And I remember a project in my rural village called the Millennium Village, which was a World Bank project. Since they left, the thing is collapsing. Because that was their project, it was not ours. Going forward, that is what we must work towards. D. Rockefeller, the great philanthropist, says, charity only begets charity. If he says so and is in charity, the sooner you wean yourself off the breasts of DFID and others, then we meet them on the dinner table of equality, you are going nowhere, number one. Number two, science and technology and innovation. Calestous Juma, writing in the book that you've read, The New Harvest, is so eloquent that until and unless Africa begins to move in the right direction in embracing science and technology, Africa is going nowhere. You know, I come from Kenya. And Kenya is one of the better African countries, believe me you. And yet Kenya is so far from where everybody else is going. So this competition that Kenya is ahead of the others, Museveni is right, is a competition of dwarfs complaining about which one is taller than the other. I'm submitting to you that we must embrace science and technology. The third thing, we must also deal with regional and international markets. You know, when leaders come and say, Agriculture, Africa Growth and Opportunities Act, that the United States of America sat down in Congress and is giving some Africans some tokenism that if you want to grow cotton, you'll take it to the United States. Complete nonsense. Africa could trade with herself. Intra-African trade is only 4%. Some now say 10%. We have food in Burundi, but it cannot be transported to Kenya. We have maize in Malawi. It cannot be transported to Kenya. Markets and markets. The other thing, transport system. I was at a forum where President Obasanjo of Nigeria said he wanted to commence a poultry farm in Liberia. He lost 40,000 chicks because there were no roads. What can we do? We who are educated here, complete with professorial titles. Reliable transport system is what we must deal with. Investment in irrigation. What are we doing? We are still waiting for God to send rain on earth, and his divine instruction was, go ye and subdue the earth. And we have allowed the earth to subdue. As I see the gentleman moving, I'll finish in 2 minutes. The other thing is the source of energy. Africa produces less energy. Africa combined produces less energy than Japan. My own country, Kenya, produces 1,600 watts per hour. That is what runs the Schiphol Airport in the Netherlands. We are not going anywhere until and unless we embrace all these things. And of course, enhancing extension services. In other words, you scientists, and this is the last point I want to make, you who are here must cascade your ideas to the ground so that the men and women in rural Africa can begin to appreciate you, so that extension farmers can begin to feel you, so that you can begin to be relevant. Otherwise, we will remain here orating ourselves in the void without much contribution. Because I want to finish on a spiritual note. You'll read my paper. And it tells you in summary that we have a problem, number one. Number two, it tells you in summary that we have opportunities. Number three, it tells you in summary that in order to seize those opportunities, we must go back to the basics. It tells you in summary that Africa must reorient and that Africa must engage in important soul searching. When he was reading the poem, he talked about prayer warriors. Africa sometimes seeks the things that require logic through illogical means. I'm submitting to you that until Africa changes her way of doing things, making effort where effort is required, embracing science where science is required, and liberating themselves from laboratories and research sites to the hard ground, Africa is going nowhere. But it can go somewhere if you men and women here on Friday take the solemn decision that what you are doing at CARI, what you are doing in your research stations will be cascaded to the African where they are at. I could have spoken on and on, but I'm being terrorized by the time managers. Thank you.